Many of the scholars have mentioned that the word itself comes from either the literal derivative of suf. Suf is simple woolen clothing. Others mention that the word comes from safa. Safa means purity. Why? Because the Sufiya are the most pure people. Others mention that the word comes from as-saf al-awwal, the front saf. So why? Because the Sufiya are in the front saf according to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the beloved Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Some mention that the word comes from, is derived from the Ahlu Sufa, the people of Sufa, in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who lived inside Masjid al-Nabawi. And from them we have the likes of Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala and many, many of the Sahaba. There's others that claim and say that the actual derivative goes back to a man who was called Sufa. Some people say that it goes back to a plant that grows in the desert called Safan. However, the closest literal definition, according to the ulama of the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, and from amongst the ulama of Ahl Sunnah, you have Abu Nasr al-Siraj al-Tusi, who died in 387, and his famous compilation in Kitab al-Nuh, he said that this derivative of Suf for the Sufiya, for the people of the Tasawwuf, is the closest definition to us. And he goes on to mention that if we were to associate the Ashab al-Hadith, the people of Hadith, to the science of Hadith, if we associate the Fuqaha with the study of Fiqh, and in terms of Ahwal, in terms of states, if we associate Zuhud with the Zuhad, with the pious people, if we associate Sabr with the Sabireen, if we associate Al-Tawakkul with the Mutawakkileen, then it only makes sense that we associate the Tasawwuf with Suf. So this is the literal definition of where it comes from. The closest definition to us is Suf. And I'm just going to mention a few points in regards to this closest definition, Suf, which literally means woolen clothing. Literally. Sayyidina Abu Musa al-Ash'ari says that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to wear woolen clothing. In Kitab al-Nur, Imam Tusi says that many of the Anbiya, the prophets that came before the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam, they used to wear woolen clothing. Why? Because it was tawadhu'an wa bu'dan lil riya, that it was their humbleness, their humility, and trying to stay away from showing off, from riya. That's why they would wear simple woolen clothing, and that was their asceticism. In regards to the Sahaba ikram, Imam Hassan al-Basri, rahimahullah, who was no doubt a Sufi himself, he says, لَكَدْ أَدْرَقْتُ سَمِينَ وَدْرِينَ مَا كَانَ لِبَاسُهُ مِنْ السُّوفِ, that I came across 70 Sahaba who participated in the battle, of Badr, and none of them wore anything except woolen clothing which was made of Suf. So the people, automatically you begin to see a correlation here developing. You see that the literal derivative of the Tasawwuf is Suf, woolen clothing, and the Sahaba ikram were the ones who used to wear woolen clothing in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. SubhanAllah. There's many, many other narrations, and in Hilyatul Awliya, Mu'ayyim, he mentions many other narrations as to how many of the Sahaba ikram, which in particular, which Sahabi used to wear these woolen clothing. But I'm not going to go into that too much. In terms of the istilahi, the technical definition of Tasawwuf, and I'm just going to mention this one point before we go into the asceticism of the Sahaba, and I'm sure you'll find that a lot more entertaining. The Imam Qushayri, Imam Shahabuddin Suharbardi, in his Awarif al-Ma'arif, Abu Nu'aym, in his Hilyat al-Awliya, they mentioned that there are over 1,000 definitions of Tasawwuf. So there's over 1,000 definitions as to what a Sufi is. We can ask ourselves, though, why is it? Why is it that there's so many definitions? A Sufi is someone who's attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then why are there over 1,000 definitions to tell us just who a Sufi is. And so Herodin is a wife of Ma'ari mentioned that the reason why there's over 1,000 definitions is that every generation, the Sufi is different from the generation that came before and the generation that comes after. So the Sufis in the time of Imam Hassan al-Basri were different to the Sufis in the time of Faliduddin al-Tariq many centuries later. So the Sufi, because of this change of the Sufiya and their state, the Ahwal, therefore the definition will always continuously change as to what constitutes a Sufi. However, according to the ulama of al-Asr, and from amongst them, we have Shaykh Abdal Hakim Murad, rahimahullah, and who was no doubt a man of the Tasawwuf himself. He says that the most accepted literal technical definition, according to the Azhari ulama, is a simple one. The simple definition mentioned in Tazkiratul Awliya by Faliduddin Attar, and that definition is of just consists of two words: Safa wa Mushahada. Purity and awareness. These are just the two simple words to describe the state of a Sufi. So a Sufi, not only is he physically pure from any type of impurity, also his ahwal al-batin, his hidden state, which only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows, is pure from any type of ghadab, is pure from any type of impurity. And the reason, now, before I go into the reasons of why Tasawwuf is needed, Alhamdulillah, we have many of the scholars here today, and I'm no scholar. You have Shaykh Abdal Hakim Murad, who's going to talk to you about Tasawwuf in the modern era, and how we can use Tasawwuf within our own lives. But I would just like to focus upon just the origins of Tasawwuf, yani in the time of the Sahaba, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with them. And I was listening to a speech by Dr. Tahir al-Qadri, may Allah preserve him, and he mentioned some fantastic points in relation to Tasawwuf and in trying to prove Sufism to be relevant to today. And he said that if you open up all the books of fiqh, any book of fiqh, whether it be Hanafi, Maliki, Hanbali, Shafi, Ja'fari, any type of fiqh, if you open up all the books of fiqh, they begin with what? They start with ahkam, they fill with ahkam. And they start with Kitab al-Tahara, for instance. You know, the book of cleanliness. And in the book of cleanliness, you have ghusl, you have how to do wudu, all full of ahkam, all full of ahkam. However, none of the books of fiqh will talk about sincerity of one's intention. None of the books of fiqh will talk about seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. None of the books of fiqh will talk about zuhud, true piety. Why? Because if you look at the first hadith mentioned in Bukhari, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. That indeed, every action is dependent and reliant upon your intention. And intention is what? Niyyah. Niyyah is mentioned in this hadith, your intention. And intention is in the heart. The sole criterion for which your acts will be judged is according to your intention. For example, if you look at our salah, salah is something which, if you look at the books of fiqh, ahkam talk to the ahkam, Imam Abu Hanifa has told us this is how you say Allah, but this is how you fold your hands together. However, if we look into tasawwuf, only then will we truly realize the reason as to why our salah would be accepted. Now, if I pray, if I come into this masjid now, and if I prayed with Salat al-Asr, for example, and before Salat al-Asr, I prayed the four sunan, and I prayed those four sunan, I saw there's many people, mashallah, there's such, so many young brothers here today, and they're gonna think that I'm a Sufi. They're Sufi, but no. So I come in, looking very nice, looking very safa, outwardly I'm looking very pure, and I begin my salah. I probably haven't even done wudu. I just want you to look at me and say, mashallah, look at him. Look at him, that brother. He's praying so much. I see him in the masjid all the time. He's continuously praying the Wahdi prayers. and I pay my full salat, is my salah going to be accepted? No. It's quite clear that my salah is not going to be accepted. Why? Because my intention is impure. If, however, I come in and I pray solely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, solely for His sake, in the condition of, with the conditions of ablution, I perform the ablution, I am pure outwardly, inwardly, and I pray for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my salah will be more likely to be accepted. The same is with fasting. If I don't eat in the month of Ramadan, from Sahri to Iftar, if I don't eat, now I'm posing this question to you. I don't eat, I stay away from all those things that are not allowed during your fast. However, I don't make the intention at Sahri time. I don't make the intention at Sahri time to fast, but I refrain from everything that constitutes a fast. Will my fast be accepted? No. Why? Because it's all about your intention. If your intention is pure, if you have promised to fast for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the next day for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, only then will your fast be accepted. Therefore, this is the tasawwuf. Your intention is in fact the tasawwuf. Why? Because the tasawwuf indicates all those internal acts. Everything that is internal, that is a matter of the tasawwuf. Everything that is external is a matter of fiqh. So there, just so briefly, for 5 or 10 minutes, I wanted to talk about the definition of the tasawwuf. So if you have any of those brothers outside, you know, you met those brothers, I met those brothers, and say, yeah, hey, what is the tasawwuf, brother? There's no such thing as the tasawwuf. This is a made-up thing. You can tell them that, no. The tasawwuf existed in the time of the Sahaba. You know, we're going to mention some of the in some of the books where we connect the tasawwuf with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam himself. The tasawwuf is taken from the seerah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. It is taken from the lives of the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam. However, when you meet those people, beware of these things. And now, inshallah, if I'm going to ask some of you brothers after we'll be here, I'm going to say, what is the literal definition of the tasawwuf? Just so that if any of those brothers were to ask you those questions, you will be able to answer them completely. I'm not going to go into the actual origins of the term in itself. Ibn Khaldun mentions in his Muqaddimah, he said that the tasawwuf basically consists of total dedication to worship.
Seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala,
that is what it, that was the embodiment of Tasawwuf, and it existed in the time of Rasulullah. The companions, they were far beyond us. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did he say? خَيْرُ قُلُونِ كَرْنِي ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يُنَّ ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يُنَّ. That the best of times is in my time, then the time that follows it, then the time that follows it. So the Sahaba ikram, they were the best of people. Therefore, although, and many of the ulama have mentioned, we don't associate the word tasawwuf with the Sahaba. Why? Because their mere suhbah with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gives them a much higher superiority. So no matter how much of a Sufi a person may be, he'll never be able to attain the rank of one who has met and lived with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's the true rank of a Sahabi. So although the word itself may not have existed in the earlier times, we see the application of tasawwuf prevalent in the life of the Sahaba. The earliest mention of the word tasawwuf or Sufi was by Imam Hassan al-Basri, who died in 110 years after Hijrah. He said that رَأَيْتُ صُوفِيًّا فِي التَّوَافِ فَأَعْطَيْتُهُ شَيْئًا فَلَمْ يَعْفُذُ. That I saw a Sufi doing tawaf and I gave him something, yani I gave him a dirham, but he did not take it from me. So this is the first time the word Sufi here is mentioned according to Ibn Khaldun. And although we've mentioned that we're not gonna talk about how tasawwuf is needed in the modern time, Shaykh Abdal Hakim inshaAllah will enlighten you as to that. Just regarding the nasha of tasawwuf, the origins of tasawwuf during the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So although the name did not exist, the Sahaba ikram, by merely calling them the Sahaba, they were the best of people. Although it did not exist, the actual application of the tasawwuf was prevalent within their lives. And I'm just going to mention to you one story which is going to prove that for you. And that story is regarding Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq, who the Naqshbandi silsila goes back to. Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq. So we can associate this with Khwaja ibn Abir rahimahullah also. During the Battle of Tabuk, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked the Sahaba for funds and asked the Sahaba to help them while they were going to, before they were going to battle. And at that time, Sayyidina Umar, he himself is narrating the story, and he said that at that time I had acquired some wealth. So I thought to myself that now I have some wealth, what am I going to do? I'm going to try and outdo Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq. You know, I'm going to try to do as much as I can, I'm trying to give as much as I can, more than Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq. Today, I'm going to outdo him. And that's according to the Quran. What does the Quran say? فَاسْتَبِقُوا الْخَيْرَاتِ. That race with one another in terms of good deeds. We do the opposite of that today. We race with one another for the dunya, for the materialistic things of the world. If somebody's got a nice new car, you know, a BMW, for instance, maybe a 59-plate BMW, and you're going to think to yourself, we're going to look at that and say, why has that brother got that car? I'm going to get a better car than this. If a man is living with his family in a 4 or 5 bedroom house, I can afford better than that. I'm going to get 6 or 7 bedroom house. So we're constantly challenging one another and racing with one another for the materialistic things of the dunya. And these were the Sahaba ikram who did not care about this. They were more worried about what can we give from the dunya to achieve the riba, to achieve the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Sayyidina Umar, he goes home and he sees that he splits up his wealth into two halves. And he leaves one half for his family and he takes one half and he gives it to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asks him, oh Umar, what have you left behind for your family? And Sayyidina Umar said, Ya Rasulullah, I've left exactly half of this for them. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam does dua for him. He prays for him and he tells him to sit down. After a while, Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu begins walking in. And Sayyidina Umar looks at him and he automatically realizes that Abu Bakr has brought everything he owns with him to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hatta even the clothes that he was wearing. He took off the clothes and he put them in his satchel and borrowed some clothes of somebody else. just so that he can give everything he had to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he came and he lays down his satchel at the feet of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him, "Oh Abu Bakr, what have you left behind for your family?" And Abu Bakr so beautifully replies, "Abkaytu Rasulullah wa Rasulullah, that I have left behind for them Allah and His Messenger. Ya Rasulullah, whatever wasn't needed for them, I've given it to you. You're asking me what I've left behind for them, I've left everything behind for them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are enough for them." After a while they're sitting down, Abu Naim in his Hilyat al-Awliya, Ibn Jawzi in his Sifat al-Safwa, Ibn Kathir in his Tafsir, they mentioned that Jibreel alayhi salatu wa salam came. And Jibreel came to the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam and says, "Ya Rasulullah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving you salam. And He is asking you to convey His salam to Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking Abu Bakr Siddiq, Hal anta an rabbika radi? That are you pleased with your Lord?" Subhanallah, Abu Bakr had attained such a state in the eye of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking him, that are you pleased with me? We don't even attain such a state where we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, "Oh Allah, are you pleased with us? Do you forgive us for our transgressions? And this was a Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking him, "Oh Abu Bakr, are you happy? In this state, are you happy with your Lord?" And when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked Abu Bakr this question and said, "Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving you salam and He is asking you, Hal anta an rabbika rad? Are you happy with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?" And the Sufiya report that he stood up, Sayyidina Abu Bakr stood up and he began to whirl. And he raised his hand up and he said, "Ana an Rabbi radin, ana an Rabbi radin, ana an Rabbi radin. I am pleased with my Lord, I am pleased with my Lord, I am pleased with my Lord." The Ahlul Tasawwuf mentioned that this was the first wajib of Islam in the presence of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the first kalimat of Tasawwuf were abqaytu Rasulullah wa Rasulullah. That I have left behind for them Allah and His Messenger. So this was the Tasawwuf. The Sahaba Ikram, they embodied this. They acted upon this. So although the word may not have existed during their time, the Sahaba Ikram were the best of people. Like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned, that the best of people lived in my time, then those that come after them, and then those that come after them. I was reading an article by Shaykh Imdad Pirzada Hussain, and he mentioned a specific hadith from Bukhari. And because I don't have much time, and it's quite a lengthy hadith, I'm just going to talk about one or two sentences from that hadith and translate it for you in English. The hadith is in regards to is a hadith qudsi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that he who is hostile to a friend of mine, I declare war against him. My slave approaches me with nothing more beloved to me than what I have made obligatory upon him. So that my slave approaches me with nothing than I have made obligatory upon him. So every single thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made obligatory upon that servant, he does for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And my slave keeps drawing nearer and closer to me until I begin to love him. And the best part of this hadith is the most beautiful part of that hadith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُهُ كُنْتُ سَمَعُهُ الَّذِي كُنْتُ سَمَعُهُ الَّذِي يَسْمَعُهُ. That when I begin to love him, I become his hearing with which he hears. وَبَصَرَهُ الَّذِي يُبْصِرُ بِهِ. And I become his sight with which he sees. وَيَدَهُ الَّذِي يَبْطُشُ بِهَا. That I become his hand with which he grasps, with which he seizes. وَرِجْلَهُ الَّذِي يَمْشِي بِهَا. And I become his legs with which he walks. And if he asks me of anything, then I will surely grant it to him. So this is the hadith the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned in Imam Bukhari. Imam Bukhari mentioned this hadith. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal also mentioned the hadith. Imam Bayhaqi ibn Shu'ab al-Iman also mentioned this hadith. So this is what a Sufi is, that people have this misconception regarding the people of Tasawwuf. They say that, you know, the Sufiya, there's no ilm, there's no knowledge amongst them, and all they have is they completely dedicate their time solely to the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they're, na'udhu billah, they're ignorant of knowledge. No. What does this hadith mention? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that my slave keeps drawing closer to me with all those things that I have made obligatory upon him. So every single thing that has been made obligatory upon that individual, he keeps doing those things, he has complete knowledge of those things, and with his nawafil he keeps drawing closer and closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why the ulama, they say that a Sufi is faqihun amila bi ilmihi fa awratha Allah ilma ma lam ya'lam. That he's a learned individual who acts upon what he says, who acts upon his knowledge and applies what he knows. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bequeaths him the knowledge of that which he does not know. So a Sufi, a person of Tasawwuf, he acts upon every single thing that he knows. So he implements Tasawwuf within his own life, and this aspect keeps drawing him nearer and closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So just to clarify that, do not think in your mind that the Sufiya or the Ahl al-Tasawwuf, they're people who are, na'udhu billah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from this belief that they are ignorant of knowledge. No doubt they have knowledge. If you look at in the books of Tasawwuf, you look at Hidayat al-Awliya by Abu Nu'aym, you look at many of the other books, if you look at Fariduddin Attar's Tazkirat al-Awliya, you see many of these stories where, Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam al-A'zam, Imam Abu Hanifa, his teacher, one of his teachers was Dawud al-Tari, who was a Sufi. You know, Imam al-Shafi, amongst his time, he had many, many of the Sufiya al-Karam. People would say that, why do you follow these Sufiya? And Imam Shafi would say that although that I may have more knowledge of hadith, I may have more knowledge of fiqh, but he knows Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala better than I do. That's why I follow him. He knows Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala better than I do. And if you look at Imam Abu Hanifa, he in Dhul Muhtar by Ibn Abidin, he mentions that regarding Imam Abu Hanifa, and Imam Abu Hanifa says that if it wasn't for two years of my life, la halak al-Nu'man, then I would have been destroyed. And those 2 years were the ones that I spent in the presence of Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq. So all the Imams of the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, Imam Shafi, Imam Malik, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Imam Hanifa, all of these Imams, they revered the Sufis. If you look at the lives of the Imams of the Ahlul Sunnah, they were Sufis themselves. They epitomized, they embodied the Tasawwuf within their own lives. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to have the same level of taqwa al-iman, and to keep Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps drawing us closer and nearer towards Him. I just want to mention to you before I leave, and I think it's my time to end my speech here, just one or two stories that I read from Fariduddin Attar's Tazkirat al-Awliya. It's regarding the great Ibrahim ibn Adham, rahimahullah, the man who sacrificed the whole of Badr. He sacrificed his whole kingdom for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibrahim ibn Adham was once on a ship, and there was a man there, and he said to Ibrahim that you sacrificed everything, God Ibrahim. You sacrificed your whole kingdom for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given you in return for that? And Ibrahim, he had a needle in his hand at the time. So he throws that needle into the sea. And then he says to the sea, give me back my needle. And all the fishes in the sea, they rise up. And in their mouths, there's a golden needle for Ibrahim. And he looks to the fishes and he says, no, I want my specific needle. The one that I was using. And then there's one fish there that opens his mouth, and inside the mouth of that fish is that needle that belonged to Ibrahim ibn Adham. So he takes the needle and he says to that man that, wallahi, this is the least of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has done to you. This is the least. You do not know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted me for me sacrificing my kingdom for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are the Sufiya al-Kiram. In what I was reading once, it's a beautiful story, and it just came to my mind now, but there were once Ibrahim ibn Adhami put his bucket in a well to take some water from the well, and when he put his bucket in, and he pulls the bucket up, we don't have to do that, he says, we just have a tap, and he pulls his bucket up, and when the bucket comes up, he sees that inside the bucket is pieces of gold, is filled with gold. So he says, oh Allah, you're offering me worldly treasure, this is not something that I require. So he lets the bucket down into the well again, and the second time he lifts the bucket up, and inside are pearls, priceless jewels. And he says, Ya Allah, you know me best of all, you know my state, you know that this is not what I require. I require simple water to complete my ablution. So let me have my water. So these people, they didn't have any, they lived such an ascetic life that the worldly pleasures around them, the materialistic forms of the dunya around them, they had no relevance to them. They did not care about these things. And the fact that they did not care about these things, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bequeathed to them knowledge of what they did not know. You say that Rabi'a al-Adawiyya, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with her. She existed in the time of Imam Hassan al-Basri. Once she was praying in her room, and while she was praying, after a while she dozed off, she fell asleep, and a thief came into the house attempting to steal whatever he could from Sayyidah Rabia al-Adawiyya. And he came in and he saw Sayyidah Rabia's chadar mubarak. So he takes the chadar, and when he lifts the chadar, he tries to get out, and he realizes there's no doors, there's no windows, and the path that he came in from is no longer there. So the path has been blocked for him. Straight away he throws down the chadar, and when he puts the chadar back down, and suddenly he's able to leave the house. So the second time he tries to do this again, and he finds the same thing. Now while he's trying to get out, while he's trying to escape, there's no way for him to escape and leave the house. After the third time, when he lifts the chadar, he hears a voice saying to him, oh you wretched soul, do you not know that even Shaytan doesn't have the audacity to come around and sneak around Sayyidah Rabia al-Adawiyya? Who are you to come? Who are you to come and think, have the audacity that we're going to steal something from Sayyidah Rabia? Do you not know that if one friend is asleep, another friend is lying awake and lying watch? SubhanAllah. So this was the maqam that the people of Tasawwuf attained. And this was that maqam that led them to being recognized as the people of Tasawwuf. And this, the recognition is not with us, the recognition is truly with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I could go on and mention to you many stories of the Sufiya al-Kiram and how they embodied Tasawwuf, but I think that it's time for me to leave. We have, alhamdulillah, the shuyukh and the scholars who are going to talk about Tasawwuf and how we can apply it within our own lives in terms of in the modern time that we're having today. Let me first of all congratulate you once again on the urso of Khwaja Zinda Pir. No doubt a blessed occasion, no doubt one of the greatest Sufis of this time. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase his daraja in Jannah and grant him, make his grave a garden from the gardens of paradise. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give me and you the tawfiq and the ability to act upon the teachings of the Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.